الحمد لله وكفى والسلام على عباده الذين اصطفى أما بعد فأعوذ بالله من الشيطان الرجيم بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم ليبلوكم أيكم أحسن عملا سبحان ربك رب العزة أما يصفون والسلام على المرسلين والحمد لله رب العالمين اللهم صل على سيدنا محمد وعلى آل سيدنا محمد وبارك وسلم اللهم صل على سيدنا محمد وعلى آل سيدنا محمد وبارك وسلم اللهم صل على سيدنا محمد وعلى آل سيدنا محمد وبارك وسلم. So in a number of places Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala tells us the story of the different prophets who came before. Sometimes it mentions the people they were sent to, the tribes that they were sent to. It talks about the message that they came with. It talks about how those people reacted, whether they accepted or whether they rejected it. Sometimes it talks about the difficulties that were put upon those prophets. And oftentimes it mentions the punishment that came upon those people who rejected the prophets that were sent to them. Whether that be by a flood, whether a storm of rocks, earthquake, various types of natural disasters. So in general, the main takeaway from those stories is that if you leave the path of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, if you reject the deen of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, then this is what's going to happen to you. This is what you should expect to happen to you. That entire cities are destroyed. That the entire earth could be flooded over to wash all the filth away. All the filth of disbelief. But sometimes Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala gives stories that take a slightly different flavor. So in Surah Buruj, there is a story that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala mentions very, very briefly. And the Prophet of Allah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam narrated in Sahih Muslim in considerable detail. So once upon a time, there was a king. A tyrannical king. And that king, as part of his court, had a sorcerer or a magician. Now the sorcerer was very powerful, but he was getting old in age. And so obviously, despite his magical skills and whatnot, nobody can delay death. Nobody can delay death. And he realized this, and the king also realized this. And so he went to the king and he said that, why don't you send me an apprentice? Why don't you find somebody young? I'm getting older. Send me an apprentice, and then over a short period of time I will train him. And then when I'm gone, you will have someone to carry on this work. So the king chose one of the youth of the area who had no natural prowess. And he said that you come in and we're basically the sorcerer will teach you, you'll learn from him, and then you will become the main sorcerer. Boy says, fine, sounds good to me. So he starts coming every day. So every day comes from his house, he comes into the sorcerer's room, chamber, and the sorcerer starts to teach him. Now it just happened that on the route that he would take between his house and going to the sorcerer was one of the followers of the religion of Isa alayhi salam in his true form. Right, so a worshiper of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And so as he would pass by, he would hear some of the teachings of this Muslim. Essentially, it was a Muslim of the time. So he would hear the teachings of this monk or this priest. And so obviously, like we mentioned before, that our ears don't have any way of closing or opening. They're always open. And so they're always picking up whatever stimuli, oral, A-U-R-A-L, oral stimuli, that's coming in. And so this stimuli happened to come into his ears, and as he would go, he would listen and he would hear a few words, and he liked what he heard. He liked what he was learning from the sorcerer, and he liked what he would hear passing by this monk. So he got more and more curious, and so he started sitting with the monk. And the more he learned from him, the more he liked it, and the more it made sense to him. So what he started doing was also sitting with the monk on a regular basis. So he would leave his house. On the way, he would stop and he would sit with the monk and he would take a lesson from him. So he would have his sabak with the monk, and then he would go and have his sabak with the sorcerer. Now this started causing problems for him, because he was supposed to be at the sorcerer at a set time. So he would leave his house, and now he's adding this extra time that he's spending with the monk. So when he would get to the sorcerer, then he would get beat, he would get hit, he would get punished. So this was becoming difficult for him. Every day going, taking a beating. And then what would happen is, because he got late going to the sorcerer, then he would get his punishment, and the sorcerer would say, but still you need to spend the time. I get 2 hours. So now he would take his 2 hours, so now he would get home late. So now he gets it again. This poor guy, he's burning the candlestick on both ends, and he's getting it everywhere. So he's trying to learn from the monk, he's trying to learn from the sorcerer, he's getting beat by the sorcerer, he's getting beat by the parents, right? He's stretched too thin. So he asks the monk what he should do. And so the monk tells him that when you go in the morning to the sorcerer, that tell him that your parents delayed you. Tell him that your parents delayed you. And this will be something acceptable to him. And when you return back to your family afterwards, tell them the sorcerer delayed you. And that'll be okay with them. Basically, keep me out of it. I'm the one that's causing this problem for you. So keep me out of it. And once you do that, then everybody will be okay that you're coming a little bit late and you're going a little bit late. And so he does this and it works out for him well. So now he's beginning to see the wisdom in the monk, outside of just the teachings that he was giving. Right? So there's a general hikmah now that is coming. Because this is what iman brings. It brings a general hikmah. And darkness takes exactly the opposite. It brings zulmat. It brings oppression. Right? Which is why he could have asked either. He could have gone to the sorcerer and said, hey, I have this problem, what should I do? Or he could have gone to the monk. Something in him told him that this person will be understanding, this person won't be understanding. So when there's truth and falsehood, there is always a natural inclination to that truth. If we can pick up on it, it can be subtle in the beginning. So obviously if the hearts are encrusted over, if the nafs is going wild, we're not going to be able to pick up on it. But somebody pure, they'll pick up on it. So he picked up on it. He picked up on it that the monk is the one who I should talk to about what I should do. So he's going to both of them, and what he's beginning to realize is that both of these things really can't be true. Both of these things can't be right. Because as he's getting more and more into the teachings, they're coming at odds with each other. The magician is calling to other than Allah. The monk is calling to Allah. So that's all there is either Allah or other than Allah. And so he starts to realize there's this dissonance within him that, you know, both of these can't be right. One has to be right and one has to be wrong. So then one day, there was a strange beast, strange to that region, who came into the marketplace where the people would come buying and selling, and it blocked the road. And so now this was a big fitna for the people, that nobody could get past, and everybody was scared of it, so nobody would approach. So the boy is passing by, and he sees all this happening, and he says, okay, this is an opportunity now to draw a clear distinction between truth and falsehood. And so he picks up a stone, a small stone, and he makes a dua to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And he says that if the teachings of the monk are more beloved to you than the teachings of the sorcerer, then kill this animal with this small pebble. Okay? So if the teachings of the monk are more beloved to you than the sorcerer's, then kill this animal with this pebble. And so he throws it, and what happens? The animal dies. So now it's clear to him. So now it's clear to him what the truth is. And now what's interesting here is that he doesn't say to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala that if the teachings of the monk are correct, or more correct, or true, and the teachings of the sorcerer are less correct, faulty, they're false. He doesn't say this. What does he say? If the teachings of the monk are more beloved to you, the pleasure of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. That's what it's about. And this is what this boy realized. And so that's how he phrased the question. Right and wrong and all these, you know, Pluto used to be a planet, now it's not a planet anymore. Right? The earth used to be square, now it's round. Right? We used to be the center of the universe, now the sun is the center of the universe. These facts come and go. So that's not what he was asking about. Not these perceived things that our mind can come and play tricks, our senses can come and play tricks. He wants to know, what's beloved to you, Allah? Whatever is beloved to you, that's what I want to do. And so Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala opens this up for him. Out of his sincerity, this poor guy, he's going every morning, taking two sabak, double sabak, getting beat left and right. So Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala opens this up for him. So now he goes back, and again, who does he tell? He doesn't tell the sorcerer, he goes back to the monk. Because now it's clear. And he tells the monk what happened. And so the monk says to him that you have surpassed me, and Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has brought a miracle through your hand, right? In the throwing of the stone and the killing of this beast. And now what he says is very interesting. And he goes on and he says, thus you will be tested. Thus you will. You surpassed me. You are now the teacher. You are now the master in this thing. You are now the carrier of the deen forward. Thus you will be tested. And then what does he say? And don't mention my name. Right? Like, don't bring me into this matter. If something happens, don't say, oh, the monk taught me all this stuff. So now from here, this boy, this youth, he starts to cure the people of different diseases, blindness, leprosy, whatever the different diseases of the time were. People would start coming, word would start spreading that he did this, and someone else would come, and someone else would come, and someone else would come. So there was actually a companion of this tyrannical king who had gone blind. And so he heard about this boy, and so he gathered together all of his treasure, and he went to the boy, and he said that if you cure me, then all of this is for you. All of this treasure that I have. And the boy responds that it's not me who cures, it's Allah who cures. So I mean, none of this dunya matters to me. This is not what it's about. I can't cure you. It's Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala that cures you. Allah cures the people. So if you accept this faith, if you accept this fact that Allah is the one who cures, then I will make dua to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala and maybe you'll get cured, if Allah wants. So this man, he doesn't care, he just wants, you know, he wants his sight back. So he says, fine. He said, I believe. And he actually believed. I mean, this made sense to him. And he had seen the miracles manifesting on the hand of this boy from before. So he says, I accept that. And so he makes dua to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, and that man's sight is restored. So he's cured. So slowly, slowly now, the jamaat, the group of the believers, is expanding. Because they're all coming, and he's saying this to everybody. Whatever they're saying to him, he's saying, it's not me that cures, it's Allah who cures. And if you believe, then I will ask Allah to cure you. And they believe, and Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala cures them. So this group is slowly, slowly getting larger and larger. So now one day the king sees his old friend, and he notices that obviously he's not blind anymore, and he says, what happened to you? You used to be blind, now you can see. And he says, your Lord and my Lord cured me. Your Lord and my Lord cured me. Now the king gets upset. And he says, you have a Lord other than me? Because this is what he thought. He thought that he was. He thought he was the Lord of everybody. The king says, you have a Lord other than me? And now he's getting agitated inside. That you would put somebody above me? So he asks his quote-unquote friend, that who told you this? Who taught you this? And so he doesn't say. He won't give it up. He won't give the name of the boy up. So the king starts to torture him. He tortures him, and then he can't take it anymore, so he gives up the name of the boy. Then they call in the boy, and he says, what is I'm hearing about another Lord? And the boy explains, this Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is doing it. I have no control over this. He believed, and we made dua to Allah, and Allah cured him. So then the king asks him, well, where did you learn this from? Where did you learn about this Allah? I mean, who's teaching you these things? You're coming every day to the sorcerer. How are you getting these things? And he says, I can't tell you. Right? He says, I can't tell you. Because the monk said to him, don't give up my name. So he begins to be tortured now. The king starts to torture the boy. So after a while, it becomes difficult for him to bear it, so he gives the name of the monk. He gives the name of the monk. So they bring in the monk, and again the king is very angry, and he's saying, who taught you this? So the monk says, this is the reality, that you are not the Lord. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is the Lord of everything. And I simply taught this boy, and he believed, and so Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala brought miracles from him. And all these other people who were cured, they all believed, and Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala cured them. So the king now says, you need to give this up. You need to give up your Islam. And the priest says, no, I can't do that. And so the king continues to insist. And he says, no, I can't do that. And so now, the king tells his guards to bring a saw. To bring a saw. And he says to the priest that if you do not recant on your beliefs, then I'm going to saw you in half. I'm going to cut you with this saw if you don't recant. And he says no. So he cuts part of his head until it gets cut and it just falls off from him. This is in front of his old companion, the old blind man, in front of the boy. He cuts and part of the head falls off and he dies. And now he says to the friend who used to be blind, you better recant or I'm going to cut you with this saw too. And despite having seen what just happened, and imagine how, a saw cutting through, just imagine, it's not like these days with all this surgical equipment that we have that you could do something like that fairly quickly. I mean, how old and how, rough that saw must have been, how long it must have taken, how much blood and how much pain and how much, and still, this man says no. So, they do the same thing to him. They cut his head and a piece of it falls off. And now to the boy. And they say, you better recant from this. And he says, no. He says, I don't care what you do to me. This is the truth, and I'm standing on the truth. And nothing's going to change my mind. So now the king doesn't do the same thing to him. He doesn't take the saw to his head and cut his head. What he does is he calls his guards, and he says, you take this boy to the top of the mountain, and give him another chance to recant, and then throw him off. If he doesn't, then you throw him off. And that's the end of it, and we're done with this matter. I don't want to deal with this anymore. So the guards take the boy, and they take him up to the mountain. And the boy, and they say, will you recant? And he says, no. He says, we're going to throw you off the mountain, then why don't you just recant? He says, no. And so he makes a dua to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, that, O Allah, save me in any way you wish. However you want to do this matter, you go ahead and do it. Save me however you want to save me. So the mountain starts to tremble, and the guards are shaken off and they fall down and they tumble to their death. And now the boy is left. Now he's free. Now he can go and he can escape, right? He can get away and he can save himself. So what does he do? He walks right back to the king. He walks right back to the king. Because he is the manifestation of truth, and that king is a manifestation of falsehood. And he needs the truth to override that falsehood. He's carrying the dawah, he's carrying the message of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala within him. He doesn't walk away, he doesn't go away, he could have ran away. He walks right back to the king. And walks in. The king is surprised at what's going on. And he said, I made dua to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, they're all dead. The king is even more angry. He calls in more guards. And he said, we just need to finish this thing. Take him out onto the ocean. And when you get out far enough, just throw him over. Just throw him over the edge and we'll be done with this. So the guards do this, they take him out. The same thing happens. That he asks Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to save me in any way that you wish. And Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala causes the boat to begin to shake. And the guards fall in and they all die. And now he's free and he can run away and escape and be free. And so what does he do? He comes right back to the king. And he walks into the court of the king again. And now he's standing there. And so now he says to the king, look, you want me dead? I understand that. I have no problem with that. But you will never be able to do it your way. You will never be able to do it your way. So I'm going to tell you how to do it. I'm going to tell you what to do so you can kill me, so you can finally be rid of me. King says, okay. He says, take me out, tie me to a tree, call all the people, take this bow and arrow, and say, in the name of Allah, and let it fly. And you do that, and I'll be dead, and you'll be rid of me. So the king does it. This is what he wants. This is the narrow-sightedness, right, of the darkness, of the zulmat. So he does it, he calls everybody out, ties the boy to the tree. And now here, the boy doesn't make a dua to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to save me in any way that you wish. Because he knows it's not about him. The only reason he made that dua before was not to save himself, but to save the message. To save that tawheed of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, that there's one Allah and he needs to be worshipped. Now he doesn't need that anymore. Because he knows the minute what happens next is the message will be propagated. So he doesn't make any dua to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala that save me however you wish. He simply stands, he waits, he's tied up, the people come, the king pulls back on the bow, he says, in the name of Allah, he lets it fly, and it hits the boy in the head, and he dies. And he dies. And now all the people see this, and they say, look, in the name of Allah, there's only one true Allah. This whole thing backfires on the king now. Now all the people who witnessed it that he had called out, they said, look, because they had all heard the story. You can imagine, right? Someone goes up to a mountain, the mountain shakes, that story would spread very, very quickly. So they had all heard this story. They all knew what was happening. And they said, here's the proof. Now it's very clear. Here's the proof. So they all accept Islam. They all accept Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Now the king has an even bigger problem. And now he's furious. Because he was duped big time. So he's furious. So what does he do? He calls in his guards. And he says to build a big trench. Throw in firewood and whatnot, oil, and start a huge fire. Start a huge fire. So the men do this. They have this huge fire boiling. And now he says to the people who have now accepted Islam, they recant or I'm throwing you in. First person says no. They throw him in the fire. Everybody else is watching this person burning to death. To the next person, recant, no, throws him in the fire. One by one by one by one, every single person there, the same thing, recant or you're going in the fire. Everybody says no. Everybody is thrown into the fire. Until at the very end, a mother comes with her child, And not because of herself, but because of the child. That she hesitates for a moment, and the child speaks and says, "Oh mother, be strong, this is the truth." And she jumps in the fire with her child, and they burn to death. MashaAllah, we've been talking over the past few days about fixing ourselves, moving closer to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, purifying the hearts, so that we can get the benefit of ibadah, so that we can enjoy standing on the musalla, so that we can wake up for tahajjud, so that we can read Quran. But we need to understand that with all of those great blessings is going to come these tests. So we need to be ready for them. We need to prepare ourselves. We need to always ask Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala for guidance, to not test us with more than we can bear. I mean, look at this boy. What he had to go through after he accepted Islam. And look at these people. It wasn't that they accepted Islam and 3, 4, 5 years later they were thrown into the... They accepted Islam and essentially a few minutes later, this fire was built. And they didn't recant. I mean, how strong was their iman? How perfected was their iman? That they said, it's fine, throw us in there. One by one by one, watching. If they were all thrown in at one time, maybe you could understand that. But every person standing in line, which means the person at the end is watching 10, 15, 20, 30, 40 people burning to death. Knowing that this is what's coming to me. And none of them, not a single one of them. And they were all burned to death. And it's interesting that this story, Surah Buruj, was revealed in Makkah. It wasn't revealed in Medina. So at a time when the Muslims are being oppressed, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is already preparing them. That mashallah, you've come this way, you've accepted the truth, but you think you're being tested now, more tests are ahead of you. So prepare yourselves now. Don't think that you can say, La ilaha illallah, and you will not be tested. Don't make that mistake. Don't fool yourself. Because the greatest tests come upon those who say, La ilaha illallah. They get, look at the prophets of Allah. Nobody was tested more than they were. In so many different ways, mentally, physically. And look at the Messenger of Allah, sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. How much he went through. 3 years boycott, coming out of Taif with the blood flowing, having entrails, garbage thrown upon him, having to watch his believers, people who because of him came into Islam, being tortured all around him. And this is why Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says in the Quran, do the people think they can claim, that they can say, yakulu, that they believe, that I believe, and they won't be tested? It doesn't work like that. The minute you say, I believe, you should be, get ready for the test. Because it's coming for sure. So the minute you step on this path, and you say that now I'm going to purify myself, now I can pray tahajjud, then there's going to be a test with that. Now I'm regular in my salat, there's going to be a test with that. Now I can sit and I can do dhikr for an hour. There's going to be a test with that. Look at the Sahaba. How often they were tested. And one of the greatest tests upon them was the loss of the beloved Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam. And we know that right after, that the Sahaba were in a very difficult shape when the Prophet passed away. It wasn't until Hazrat Abu Bakr came and brought everybody back to their senses. That test was so difficult that it took the greatest of the Sahaba to pull them out from that. Look at our ulama who come after that. Imam Malik, Imam Ahmad. So many of our ulama tortured and in jail. So many of them. From that time until now. Look at Imam Bukhari. Three times he was thrown out from where he had been invited to come and teach. Three times. Kicked out of his own hometown. Can you imagine that? I mean, look at the place that we give Imam Bukhari. Can you imagine that his people of his own time kicked him out 3 times from where he was and said, just get out. We don't want you teaching here anymore. That same Sahih Bukhari that's in every masjid now, along with side by side with the Quran. Look at how these people were tested. Because they achieved greatest, the highest ranks in Islam. And so the test came for them. Those tests were even harder than anybody else. The tests had come upon other people. The more you achieve, the more you're going to get tested. This is qaida kulliya. It's a principle across the board. The more that you believe, the more that you will be tested. When Imam Ahmad was in his final moments, and he was laying on the deathbed, and he was from the pangs of death, he was coming in and out of consciousness. He was coming in and out of consciousness. And one time, his son was there, and he happened to hear him say, no, not yet. No, not yet. And now his son is worried. His son is worried. That, mashallah, my father has done so much work and received so much acceptance from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, but in this last test, he's failing. He's saying that no death, not yet. I'm not ready to go. No death, not yet, I'm not ready to go. Right? Because we should desire to meet our Lord. When our time comes, we should happily go. So he's very worried. So when Imam Ahmad comes into consciousness, now he comes and he says that, you know, this is what I heard from you. You know, I'm very worried. What were you saying? Did you know what you were saying? What was happening? And so Imam Ahmad explains that Shaitan came to me. That Shaitan came to me. Because Shaitan's not going to leave you until you're gone. So Shaitan came to me. And he was biting on his fingers. You know, like when people get very, very sorrowful, they start biting on their fingers. So Shaitan was doing this. He was biting on his fingers. And he said, oh Ahmad, you have slipped out of my hands. Right? Trying to get that arrogance to come in him. So that everything can be washed away. So that his entire life can be thrown away. Oh Ahmad, you have slipped through my fingers. Right? MashaAllah, you did it. You saved yourself from me. This is Shaitan. This is Shaitan. And that's why he said, no, not yet. He said, no, I haven't saved myself from you yet. Our battle is still going on. When my heart stops beating, then yes. Until then, no, not yet. You're still my enemy. No, not yet. I'm still gonna fight you. No, not yet. The tests are still gonna come. No, not yet. This is what he said. So we have to realize that as we move further and further along on this path, these tests are gonna come. And this is why it's so important to maintain the contact with the ulama, with the mashayikh. Because when those tests come, then you go to them, you turn to them, you let them guide you through them. Because they themselves have already gone through it, and they've already guided other people through it. Shaitan is never going to go away. Shaitan is never going to give up. Look at what he was doing to Imam Ahmad until the very end. Your nafs is not going anywhere, it's stuck with you. These enemies are not going anywhere. Which means we have to be very, very vigilant. And they are going to keep coming and keep testing us. لِيَبْلُوَكُمْ أَيُّكُمْ أَحْسَنُ أَمَلًا. To see which of you, this is why Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala does it. He does it out of love for you. He wants to see which one of you is the best. So that on the day of judgment, then he can give you that jannah accordingly. On the day of judgment, the person who made 2-3 subhanAllah extra is going to be in a slightly higher jannah. Not a single morsel of good will go that there's not a differentiation between this person and that person. That's why Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is doing it. For your benefit. For our benefit. So we need to make sure that we pass these tests. We need to make sure that we are ready. We need to know that these tests are going to come no matter what. And they will come over and over again. And the further and further and the further along you go on this path, the closer you get to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, the tests will just come more and more. And they will become harder and harder. But Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala never tests anybody with what they cannot bear. He never tests anybody with what they cannot bear. So you know that you can pass the test. If you utilize the tools at your disposal, if you have patience, if you have sabr, if you stay close to the ulama, if you stay close to the mashayikh, if you continually take from them, if you humble yourself, if you put yourself before Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala and admit how weak you are, that except for Allah's helping you, there's nothing. That boy, he easily could have said, yeah, yeah, I'm curing everybody. Look at me. He never did that. He said, it's Allah. But if you want, I'll make dua for you. It's Allah. And if you want, I'll make dua for you. Wa akhiru da'wana, alhamdulillahi rabbil alameen.